The pelvis consists of a bony ring made up of two innominate bones in the front and the sides and a sacrum along with the coccyx posteriorly. This bony ring helps to transmit weight from the upper part of the body to the lower limbs, and in the female it acts as a birth canal through which the fetus passes during labor. Each innominate bone is made up of ilium, ischium and the pubis. There are four joints, the pubic symphysis, two sacroiliac joints and one sacrococcygeal joint. The pelvis is divided into two parts, that is the false pelvis or the greater pelvis and the true pelvis or the lesser pelvis, which is separated by the pelvic brim or the pelvic inlet. The true pelvis is of interest to the obstetrician. The true pelvis consists of an inlet, cavity and an outlet. Now let's have a look at the pelvic inlet. The pelvic inlet starts from the sacral promontory, the anterior border of the ala of the sacrum, the sacroiliac joint, the iliopectineal line, the iliopectineal eminence, pectineal line, pubic tubercle, pubic crest, and the pubic symphysis. It is also called the inlet or the superior strait. Now, the iliopectineal line, the pectineal line, and the pubic crest together is called the linea terminalis. Now we'll have a look at the diameters of the pelvic inlet. The inlet has got an anteroposterior diameter which starts from the midpoint of the sacral promontory to the upper border of the pubic symphysis, which measures around 11 centimeters. A transverse diameter which joins two points on the widest part of the linea terminalis, and it measures 13 centimeters. There are two oblique diameters. The right oblique is from the right sacroiliac joint to the opposite iliopubic eminence, and the left is from the left sacroiliac joint to the opposite iliopubic eminence. It measures around 12 centimeters. Another diameter in the inlet which is of interest is called the posterior sagittal diameter, which is from the sacral promontory to the point of intersection of the anteroposterior and the transverse diameter. This measures around 4.5 centimeters, and as we go down into the cavity and the outlet, this posterior sagittal diameter progressively increases. There are three anteroposterior diameters of the inlet. The first one is called the anatomical conjugate. It is also called the true conjugate or the conjugate vera, and it measures 11 centimeters. The second is the obstetric conjugate, which is from the sacral promontory to the most prominent point on the inner surface of the pubic symphysis. This measures 10 centimeters. This is what is of interest to the obstetrician. That's why it's called obstetric conjugate. The conjugate that can be measured by clinical pelvimetry is called the diagonal conjugate, which starts from the sacral promontory to the lower border of the pubic symphysis, and it measures 12 centimeters. So once we measure the diagonal conjugate and deduct 2 from it, we get the obstetric conjugate. Now let's see how the diagonal conjugate is measured. Diagonal conjugate is one of the diameters that can be measured by clinical pelvimetry. It is a distance between the midpoint of the sacral promontory and the lower border of the pubic symphysis. So this distance is measured, that is 12 centimeters in a normal pelvis, and when we deduct 2 centimeters from the diagonal conjugate, we get the obstetric conjugate. So next we come to the pelvic cavity. The pelvic cavity is bounded above by the inlet and below by the outlet. In the cavity there are two planes, the plane of greatest pelvic dimensions and the plane of least pelvic dimensions. The cavity is almost rounded, and therefore the anteroposterior diameter is equal to the transverse diameter, and it measures 12 centimeters. Now we'll have a look at the plane of least pelvic dimensions. The plane of least pelvic dimensions passes from the lower border of the pubic symphysis to the ischial spine, sacrospinous ligament, and the tip of the sacrum. The outlet of the pelvis consists of two triangles with their base formed by the line joining the two ischial tuberosities. Anteriorly, it starts from the lower border of the pubic symphysis, the ischiopubic rami, the ischial tuberosity, the sacrotuberous ligament, and the tip of the coccyx. The transverse diameter of the outlet is around 11 centimeters, and the anteroposterior diameter, which is largest of the outlet, measures 13 centimeters. Now let's look at the anatomical position of the pelvis. Normally when a patient stands upright, the anterior superior iliac spine and the pubic symphysis happen to be in the same straight line. Now let's have a look at the angle of inclination. The angle of inclination is the angle made by a line passing through the front of L5 vertebra and the plane of inlet. It is around 135 degrees. It can also be defined as the angle made by the plane of inlet with the horizontal, and that is 55 degrees. In conditions where this angle increases, that is in sacralization of the fifth lumbar vertebra, it is called a high assimilation pelvis. In high assimilation pelvis, the uterine axis does not coincide with the axis of the pelvic inlet, which results in delay in engagement and occipital posterior position. A low assimilation pelvis, which is seen in lumbarization of the fifth circle sacral vertebra, is of no obstetric significance. Another angle which can be seen here is a sacral angle, which is an angle formed by a line passing through the front of the first sacral vertebra and the plane of inlet, which is 90 degrees. When we draw a line joining the axis of the inlet, the cavity and the outlet, it forms a curve which is called the curve of Caris, and this is the route that the fetus takes normally during its transit in the pelvic canal. Initially, this axis is directed downwards and backwards, then it is directed downwards, and in the outlet it is directed downwards and forwards. Waist space of Morris. When we keep a disc of diameter 9.5 centimeters between the two pubic rami, the distance between the lower border of the pubic symphysis to this disc should not be more than 1 centimeter. This space is called the waist space of Morris. When the two pubic rami are close together, or the angle, subpubic angle, is very acute, this waist space of Morris increases. This is the Cardwell and Molloy classification of different types of pelvis. The commonest one is a gynecoid pelvis, where the inlet is round or oval in shape, with a well-curved sacrum, parallel sidewalls, and a wide subpubic angle. The platypaloid pelvis, which is rarely seen, is a flat pelvis, where the transverse diameter is more than the AP diameter. It is in this condition that engagement occurs by asyncretism, with the suprasuprarightal diameter engaging or entering the pelvis. The male pelvis is called the android pelvis, where the inlet is heart-shaped and the sacrum is jutting inside with convergent sidewalls and a narrow subpubic angle. An anthropoid pelvis is a pelvis where the AP diameter is more than the transverse diameter. Sometimes it might not be a purely gynecoid pelvis, there can be combinations. So the posterior aspect might look or have the features of a gynecoid pelvis, but the anterior aspect might have features of an android pelvis. So we call the pelvis a gynecoid pelvis with an android tendency. We as doctors, most of us are very bad with numbers. Anyway, there's a very easy way to learn the different diameters of the pelvis. Just remember three numbers: 11, 12, and 13. Now, already we've seen that the cavity is rounded, the AP, the oblique, and the transverse diameters are the same. So 12 is a number in between. So we take 12. So it's 12 centimeters anteroposterior, 12 centimeters oblique diameter, and the transverse diameter is also 12 centimeters. Now the inlet, as we all know, is widest in the transverse plane. So the transverse diameter is biggest in the inlet, and it is around 13 centimeters. But as we go towards the outlet, the anteroposterior diameter is the widest, and that is 13 centimeters. So the number that we are left with is 11. So that forms the anteroposterior diameter of the inlet and the transverse diameter of the outlet. The inlet, we have seen all the anteroposterior diameters, and of that, to remember, is the obstetric conjugate, which is 10. So the 0 in the 10 and the O in the obstetric will help us to remember that obstetric conjugate is 10 centimeters. The oblique diameters are the same in all levels. It is 12 in the inlet and 12 in the cavity. Assessment of diameters of the pelvis can be done by clinical examination, which is called clinical pelvimetry, or by X-ray or ultrasound. However, as Pinard has rightly stated, the fetal head is the best pelvimeter. The fetal skull consists of the vault, the face, and the base of the skull. The vault of the skull, which is compressible to some extent, is made up of flat bones which are united together by non-ossified membrane. Where two bones meet, it is called a suture, and where more than two bones meet, it is called a fontanelle. The sagittal suture lies between the two parietal bones. The frontal suture lies between the two frontal bones. The coronal suture lies between the parietal bone and the frontal bone. And the lambdoid suture lies between the occipital bone and the two parietal bones. These sutures permit gliding movement of one bone over the other, and this is called molding. This can help to overcome mild degree of capillopelvic disproportion. Severe irreducible molding is a sign of obstructed labor. Digital palpation of the sutures help in assessing rotation of the head and the manner of engagement, whether it is asyncretic or syncretic. Fontanelles are wide gaps of membrane, and they are 6 in number, 2 of which are of obstetric significance. The bigger one is called the anterior fontanelle, which is diamond shaped, and it is formed by the joining of 4 suture lines. It normally gets ossified by 18 months. Palpation helps to assess the degree of flexion. If the anterior fontanelle is felt very easily on vaginal examination, it means that the head is either deflexed or extended. The posterior fontanelle is triangular in shape, and it is formed at the junction of 3 suture lines. When it is felt easily on vaginal examination, it means that the head is well flexed. Since it is very close to this prominence called the occiput, the position of this fontanelle will help us to ascertain the various positions of the fetal head. Coming to the areas on the fetal skull, the first one is the vertex. The vertex is an area which is bounded by the anterior fontanelle, the posterior fontanelle, and the two parietal eminences. This is the most common presenting part. The next is brow, which is from the anterior fontanelle to the root of the nose. Another term that is normally used is the bregma. Bregma is nothing but the center of the anterior fontanelle. The face starts from the root of the nose to the chin. Now coming to the diameters. The important anteroposterior diameters of the fetal skull are suboccipitobregmatic. This is the occipital protuberance. So suboccipitobregmatic, which is 9.5 centimeters. This is the engaging diameter for a vertex presentation. The next is submentobregmatic. This is the presenting diameter for face presentation, which is also 9.5 centimeters. The next is, for brow presentation, the engaging diameter is mentovertical. That's from the chin to the highest point on the vertex. And this is 13 centimeters. The transverse diameter is the biparietal diameter, and it is around 9.5 centimeters. So on the fetal skull, there are 3 diameters that are 9.5. The biparietal, the suboccipitobregmatic, and the submentobregmatic. There is another diameter on the fetal skull which is called the supra-subparietal diameter. That is, one point it is below the parietal eminence and on the opposite side it is above the parietal eminence. This is 8.5 centimeters. This is just to show the various areas on the fetal skull. This is the occiput from the posterior fontanel to the anterior fontanel, that's a vertex, and from the anterior fontanel, that's a brachma of the anterior fontanel, to the root of the nose is a sensiput. Then coming to the various diameters, this is the suboccipito-brachmatic for vertex, submento-brachmatic for face, and vertico-mental for brow presentation. Occipito-frontal diameter is a diameter for the deflexed head.